Please come to order. Good evening and welcome to the Commissioner's fourth public hearing on proposed Code Home Rule form of government being held tonight, January 19, 2016, at the Bay District Volunteer Fire Department. I am Randy Guy, President of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County. I'd like to introduce the other commissioners to my right, representing the first Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Bonnie Point, St. George's Island, Commissioner Tom Jarboe.
Good
evening. Seated next to Commissioner Jarboe, representing the second Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown and Hollywood, Commissioner Mike Hewitt.
Good evening.
To my left, John O'Connor, who represents the third Commissioner District, which includes Charlotte Hall, 7th District, and Golden Beach.
Good evening.
Mr. Tom Morgan will not be here tonight. He has some other pressing duties that come to. Seated next to Commissioner O'Connor is Dr. Rebecca Bridget, our County Administrator. And next to Dr. Bridget is County Attorney Mr. George Sparling. And seated next to Mr. Sparling is Leslie Knapp, Jr., Legal and Policy Counsel for MACA, which is the Maryland Association of Counties, which will be giving his presentation tonight. On my immediate right is Ms. Sharon Ferris, who is our recorder, and Ms. Amy Carter, our video media producer, over there behind the camera, is recording this meeting tonight for future broadcast on Channel 95, and also to be online too, right? Okay, Commission wanted to thank the Bay District Volunteer Fire Department for your hospitality and allowing us the use of your facility. Thank you very much, sir. Before we begin, I'd like to ask everyone to please turn your cell phones off or on vibrate. The purpose of tonight's public hearing is to provide information on the Code Home Rule form of government and to receive your comments. This is the fourth of seven public hearings scheduled over 6 months to offer information on Code Home Rule form of government and to get your input. We will begin with opening remarks from the commissioners. Mike, do you have anything?
Let's get this show on the road.
Tom?
Just thank you very much for taking the time to come out. The weather's not conducive for travel, but I do appreciate you taking the extra time and effort to come out and get it for me.
Thank you for taking the time to come out and show an interest in the community and your county government and the form of government that is here to serve you. Thank you again.
And for those of you who are listening and you have more than enough time to respond, not verbally, you can send us an email or mail. We appreciate it very much. But this is online, and this entire briefing will be online, including the slides and, of course, the video monitoring will be online. And I would now like to turn it over to Mr. Les Knapp for his presentation. Yeah, we're all going to move out from the to here to the front so we can better see it.
Okay, well, good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out, especially in this cold weather. I am going to apologize up front that this weather is messing with my sinuses, so if I have to stop and take a drink of water, that's just to keep my voice going and not go into a coughing fit. As was noted, my name is Les Knapp. I'm the Legal and Policy Counsel for the Maryland Association of Counties, or MACO. I'm always happy to get back down to Southern Maryland. I grew up on a farm in neighboring Culver County, and once that's done, I'm gonna, rather than drive back up to Annapolis, I'm gonna crash at my parents' house in front of a big fire. So thank you for that. MACO is, we will not paint your car, but we do represent all 23 counties and Baltimore City before the Maryland General Assembly, and occasionally offer comments at the federal level on issues that affect all of Maryland's county governments. And we are nonpartisan and nonprofit. So my goal tonight here is to provide you with information on the three forms of county government that exist, particularly focusing on the current commission form and the proposed Code Home Rule form for St. Mary's, but it is not my purpose to tell you what you should make. The ultimate decision is to take the information I provide and you get from other sources, and as the citizens of your county, decide what form of government will best achieve your long-term policies and goals. So with that in mind, I'm going to run through a presentation. If you have any questions, I will happy to answer them, although I ask you hold them towards the end, and we will have a formal session on that, and I'll stick around as long as needed. So first off, kind of cover the types of county governments in Maryland. And there are 24 counties in the state, 23 counties plus Baltimore City, which legally counts as both a county and an incorporated city. And of these 24 counties, there are three types of county governments. You have commission form of government, which has six counties in it: Calvert, Carroll, Garrett, St. Mary, Somerset, and Washington. You have the charter form of government, which has 12 counties in it: Anne Arundel, Baltimore City, Baltimore County, Cecil, Dorchester, Frederick, Hartford, Howard, Montgomery, Prince George's, Talbot, Wicomico, and finally, Code Home Rule counties. There's six of those: Allegheny, Caroline, Charles, Kent, Queen Anne's, and Worcester. And if you go, it's interesting to note there's a broad range here, particularly in the charter class. There is no particular partisan or size requirement. You have small to mid-sized counties as commission counties, small to mid-sized counties as code home rules, and some small, mid, and large counties as charters. And you have some very liberal or progressive counties with charter forms of government. You also have some very conservative counties with charter forms of government. So there is no single partisan or political connection to any of these forms. So I think the next question is, why do we have three forms of county government? And then there's two, I think, key points to understanding that. The first is Maryland counties are extremely diverse and have vastly different local needs and demographics. And in a way, that's both a blessing and a curse, but we have much higher diversity within our counties than almost every other state. A couple of factoids. The estimated total population as of July 1st, 2016 for Montgomery County is over 1 million people, as number one, all the way down to Kent County, which is barely pushing 20,000 people. St. Mary's is ranked in the middle at 12th with 112,000 people. Same thing with population density. Baltimore City, with over 7,600 people per square mile, is number one, all the way down to Garrett County, which has the extremely sparse 45 people per square mile. So if you don't like lots of people and like lots of breathing room, Garrett County may be the place for you. Again, St. Mary's is kind of ranked in the middle at 13. You have 314 people per square mile. Finally, look at your budgets. For the approved FY 2016 operating budgets, Prince George's County has the highest with $2.95 billion, all the way down to Somerset County on the Eastern Shore with an annual budget of $35.2 million. Again, St. Mary's falls into the middle with an annual budget of $227 million. So what's the one takeaway from this? One size does not fit all, and that's why you have differing governments. The other answer to that question is Maryland counties are very unique in the nation in that they are either mandated by the state or have powers to provide services that go far beyond what most other counties and most other states provide. And I'm not going to go through each piece here, but just be aware, your county governments fund your community colleges. They issue debt. They do a variety of general government support, including supporting the judiciary, running elections, financial administration, legal personnel, alcoholic beverage control. They fund and maintain local health departments. They fund and maintain your public schools, K-12 education. They're responsible for a broad array of land use, planning, development, zoning, and economic development. They fund libraries. They provide public safety, either through sheriff's offices, police departments, and EMS services. They do public works, road maintenance, and infrastructure maintenance, and they run parks and recreation facilities. So this is a huge laundry list of tasks from which they have to do. And again, the idea has been multiple types of governments are needed to best fit the needs of your county. So now I'm going to kind of talk about the different forms of government, starting with commission. This is the original form of county government and was used by all counties except Baltimore City up until the early 20th century. And not surprisingly, and St. Mary's is obviously a commission government, and you're governed by a group of county elected officials called commissioners. And per the Maryland Constitution, a commission county can only legislate in areas where the General Assembly has given them authority. And while these areas have increased over time, they're still more narrowly construed than that of a charter or code home rule county. and a General Assembly can enact legislation affecting a single commission county, and exact powers do vary from commission county to commission county because of this. So some of the examples recently, and this was compiled by the state's Department of Legislative Services, and looking from 2011 to 2014, they assembled a list of some of the areas where the General Assembly has been involved with commission counties. You have regulation of local roads, sale of county property, fees to water, sewer service, solid waste disposal, abatement of nuisances, salaries and benefits of county officers and employees, term limits and the filling of vacancies in a board of county commissioners, litter control, animal control, and at least in one county, a repeal of a local ban on fortune telling. So moving to the charter form of government, I'm just going to really provide a little bit here for context. This was the second form of government for counties in Maryland. It was created in 1915, and it was done primarily to reduce the glut of local measures that the General Assembly had to deal with, and as a result, many of them got unpassed in the final days of the legislative session. And two, it was also to allow local legislation to be enacted solely by those directly affected. Again, the authority for a charter form of government is found in the Maryland Constitution, and it requires the General Assembly to grant express powers to charter counties to legislate certain matters. The county is limited to matters expressly described in this grant of powers, and that is found in Title 10 of the Maryland Code's Local Government article. And it basically is a list of the powers that are reserved to charter counties. A charter county's basic form of governmental structure is laid out in a document called a county charter, and it's really analogous to a constitution. Most charter counties have a county council and a county executive, but several do work through kind of a county council, county manager form instead. The General Assembly cannot pass laws affecting a single charter county if the subject is contained in the express powers grant, but may do so if it affects two or more charter counties. And so in the Maryland Code, you will see some strange groupings of counties as legislation was passed. And that brings us to the third and final form, and the one which you're considering, that is the Code Home Rule form of government. This was created in 1966 by a constitutional amendment, and really is kind of, I think, on the spectrum. If you have the commission county at one end of the spectrum, the charter county at the other, Code Home Rule sort of falls into the middle. A code county has broad authority to enact public local laws without the need for a charter. And the code county's legislative authority is found both in the Maryland Constitution and in the Maryland Code. A county that opts to become a code county may organize parts of its government, reorganize parts of its government, but it does not have to dramatically change it. And some have never really changed much and retained the basic commissioner structure. Now, what constitutes a public local law? That's been kind of subject to some debate, and the Office of the Attorney General in Maryland has stated that the code county's authority should be broadly construed. Now, in practice, code home rule counties may enact legislation in similar areas to charter counties, although the procedures pertaining to certain areas, such as, say, indebtedness, are somewhat different. And unlike commissioner and charter counties, the General Assembly must enact laws applicable to code home rule counties as a class. And it may not enact laws that only apply to a single county, code county, unless there is only one code county in that class. And the classes the General Assembly have created are based on geography. Right now, there are four classes: Central Maryland, the Eastern Shore, Southern Maryland, and Western Maryland. So this means that right now Charles County is the only code county in Southern Maryland, so the General Assembly can basically pass legislation affecting just that county because it's the only one there. Allegheny County is similar out in Western Maryland. But in the other areas of the state where you have multiple code counties, they have to enact legislation that affects all of those counties within that one geographic class. So if St. Mary's were to become a co-county, then the General Assembly could only pass legislation that affects them and Charles County, since they're in that same class. And note, this just applies at the state level for what the General Assembly does. If Charles County is a co-county, or St. Mary's was to become a co-county, local legislation passed in Charles County would have no effect on St. Mary's County and vice versa, just as it is now, that those are your local laws. There is one exception to this class requirement, and that is the General Assembly may set a maximum property tax rate or level of indebtedness for a specific code county. However, to date, they have never exercised that authority. So that's kind of the broad scope of the three types of government. I'm now going to walk through some specific issues. And I know I've submitted, and I believe it is online available along with these slides, a chart that provides much more detail about these differences, not only for code, home rule, and commissioner counties, but it also includes how it would work in a charter county. So I'm just going to kind of go through several, and starting with body authority. So in a commission county, the General Assembly must specifically authorize any bonds that are to be issued, and there's no statutory limitation on the amounts. For a code home rule, the county commissioners would authorize the bonding level. There is no statutory maximum, but as I noted, the General Assembly may establish a limit. This is also, though, subject to a local referendum if petitioned by 10% of the voters. So that is different from a commission county in that there's a specific referendum provision provided for setting a limit on bonding. In the term of tax caps, for a commissioner county, the General Assembly may establish that. But for a code home rule, it is up to the county commissioners. County commissioners may not enact, and the General Assembly may, however, enact a tax cap for a code county. So there's no difference there. It's the General Assembly's call on tax caps. For referendum, for a commission county, public local laws in a commission county are subject to a referendum if petitioned by 10% of the registered voters. The General Assembly may enact public local laws contingent on the approval of by referendum. For a code home rule county, all legislation is subject to a referendum if there's a petition filed with the Board of Election Supervisors by 10% of the registered voters. So again, not too much difference there. In terms of enacting new taxes, licenses, or franchise fees for a commissioner county, the General Assembly authorization is needed. But for a code home rule, General Assembly authorization is also required. And you cannot create new taxes, license, or franchise fees that are not authorized at the time the county got its home rule status. So if, for example, St. Mary's County is a commissioner county now, they have an impact fee that's currently in existence that was authorized by the General Assembly, and they have the county commissioners have the authority to modify that fee. If they changed over to a code home rule, they would retain the authority to modify that fee because it pre-existed the time of changing over. But if they wanted to create a new fee or something different, they would still then have to go to the General Assembly. So again, broadly, no real difference there. In terms of impact fees, the commissioners, General Assembly must establish and authorize the use of impact fees in a commissioner county, but in a code home rule county, it's up to the commissioners to establish. Similar with tax credits, in both instances, General Assembly authorization is needed to provide tax credits, both for commission and code home rule. For planning and zoning authority, it's pretty much the same. You're subject to state law, and no type of county really has a lot of flexibility with land use. That remains a power of the state. In terms of declaring or levying civil penalties, infractions, or fees for enforcement of laws, for a commissioner county, the General Assembly must specifically authorize. For a code home rule county, the county commissioners may enact, but it is subject to certain limitations. For excise taxes, the General Assembly must authorize for a commission county. And for a code home rule, the commissioners may enact a school construction excise tax up to $750 per lot if it is not already levying a development impact fee. Additionally, they may also enact an agricultural excise tax up to $750 per lot for the purchase of transferable development rights if the county is not levying a development impact fee already. So there are a few restrictions there as to what can be done locally. Turning to kind of the formality of the legislative process and procedures, there are little differences here. For Commissioner County, it's largely informal. There's no provisions that specifically cover setting of legislative days, how the county handles emergency bills, or publication of proposed bills. That's pretty much decisions made up to the county. But for a code home rule, there is a little more formality, and the annotated code of the state does specify the precise format, the maximum number of legislative sessions, how public notification is to occur, provisions on how emergency bills are handled, effective dates, publication of proposed bills, etc. So there is actually a tweak in the law where code home rule has a little more requirements than a commissioner county does. In terms of the number of commissioners or council members and their method of election, the General Assembly for a commissioner county will set the compensation. There's an informal salary board that may be established to make recommendations to the General Assembly, but ultimately it's the General Assembly that decides the compensation. For a code home rule, the commissioners may enact a recommendation of a salary commission that is established by ordinance. Finally, the ability to establish separate police and corrections departments. For a commissioner county, again, you have to get General Assembly approval. For a code home rule, a corrections department or warden may be done through enactment by the commissioners through a public local law, but if you want to establish a police department, it still requires General Assembly approval. So kind of, I know I threw a lot of examples at you. Again, all of the details are in the charts that should be available online with this presentation. But kind of broad line, you know, what are the advantages and drawbacks of each form? Well, commission is the oldest form. It's the most simple for a small to mid-sized county. It can work very well. The advantages of the code home rule are you have a little more local autonomy in some areas. You still have to go to the General Assembly for a number of critical things, but there are some things that your commissioners can make decisions on. And it really, unlike a charter form of government, doesn't really require you to have a dramatic upheaval of your county government. You can retain your commission structure and not have a lot of changes. Before I turn this over to questions, a couple of other specific questions that I'd previously gotten that I want to pre-answer. One is, if the county changes form of government and citizens don't like it, can they change back or to another form? And the answer is yes. I'm not aware of any county in the history of the state that has done that, but there's no provision in the law that does not prohibit bringing a new proposal, putting it to referendum, and changing form. The other issue that seems to be asked here is, if the county changes over to a code home rule form of government, can they set term limits on Board of Education members? And the answer to that is no. They would have to go to the General Assembly and have a statute passed to change or set term limits for Board of Education members. So with that, I'm going to conclude and provide you a couple of other sources of information. And my contact information, I'm happy to answer questions from both the audience here or anybody who has seen this online and wishes to contact me. I will do my best to provide answers to your questions.
Anybody have any questions?
So things like dog licenses, personal property, business tax, things like that, those all fall under the licensing and tax area that still remain with the state?
Yes. Now, the General Assembly can, for classes of counties, just do a broader delegation of authority, but ultimately, yes, a lot of that will still remain at the state level. There are, as I noted, there are certain fees and things that would be available, that the commissioners and would be done locally, but the broad taxes, yes.
Like they currently do, they can set those too when they go up.
Yes.
And tax them out. So that won't change. We're going to go to home rule. We'll still be on top of it.
Yes.
I'm going to bring the lights up a little bit. There you go. Thanks. Good. Anyone else got a question? Now it's time to ask it. Man's always down from Annapolis, now we're stopped, so. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. I have heard from somebody who heard a different presentation on this that there was some question about, really, and perhaps this goes to the county commissioners themselves, but how many laws, how much proposed legislation actually does typically go from a county up to Annapolis and await some sort of action? I see that there's a division of things, but I don't really understand the percentages in terms of what needs to get done, and therefore how much is the county being impeded or held back in trying to accomplish things while waiting for Annapolis?
That's a tough question to answer because it's dependent on a lot of different factors. The needs, obviously, of the county vary from year to year. There may be a year where a lot more changes are in response to perhaps some changes in local conditions or wanting to get a business or a public safety issue happens, like most of the state is grappling with a heroin epidemic right now. There may be a push for different legislation. And it also depends on the amount of bills before the state General Assembly that are not locally generated bills. There's a question that in general, if you went to a code home rule, there would be a number of bills that you could handle locally in terms of public local laws that you would not have to take the General Assembly. This year, the General Assembly typically handles 24 to 2,600 bills. This year, there are already over 2,100 bills in the first week of session, so they're looking that they could set an all-time record with the number of bills. Undoubtedly, with that many bills, there are local measures that will just get tabled or shelved. Sometimes, if they're very complex, the General Assembly may take several years or more to get them through because the General Assembly needs time to understand that. And so there is an advantage there, but it does vary a lot, so it's hard to say a concrete number.
So what happens up there? A law doesn't get sent into thin air. It goes from somebody's hands to somebody's hands to somebody's hands. Could you about how many steps there are and who's responsible for
them? I will give a greatly condensed response because I could literally take another hour just on how a bill is introduced and becomes a law in Annapolis. But broadly, obviously somebody has that idea, whether it's a county official or a citizen, they take it to their state legislator. That legislator then, if they like that idea, we'll go to the Department of Legislative Services, which is the state's nonpartisan staff for the General Assembly. They do all of the bill drafting. So the legislator could just take a paragraph describing the idea. They could try to take a stab at statutory construction. I'll say as a former bill drafter, sometimes that works well, but sometimes it's just better off to give us a paragraph because it's hard to draft to the law and code. Once the legislative services has it, they will actually draft a bill. It's a draft bill. The legislator will typically take it around to get some co-sponsors and other legislators to sign on as supporters. Then the bill gets dropped in and formally printed. It goes before the House or the Senate, depending on whether the legislator introduced it was a senator or a representative. It will get assigned to a committee, have a hearing. It gets very complicated then. Some committees will send it to a subcommittee for review and then back to the full committee. Sometimes the full committee will just review the bill. Ultimately, they'll kill the bill, vote it out, or vote it out with amendments and changes. It then goes to the full floor of that House, get amended further, killed, or just voted clean, and then it goes over to the other house where it basically repeats that process. So there are many steps involved, and 90 days, especially towards the end, gets very crazy as bills are being pushed hard to be passed.
You're asking really good questions,
okay.
So please go
okay.
down the street.
Keep going, you're doing good.
The people who are voting on it are people from all, are representatives from all over the state who, in one way or another, have usually very little stake in or very little interest in what happens in one particular county.
That is correct. Now, there is a concept called local courtesy, which is usually but not always followed, which is if your regional legislators, your delegation for St. Mary's County, says that they support the bill, then if the membership follows local courtesy, they'll all just vote for the bill and trust the wisdom of your local state legislators. Every now and again, depending on the issue, local courtesy can get dropped, but for the most part, it is followed. There are literally thousands of ways to kill a bill. They're all used, some of which are specifically designed not to leave political fingerprints. So it is very hard to specifically tag the number of local bills where local courtesy was ignored versus where it was killed through some other way for the same result.
May I add an example? Last year?
Yeah, please.
So last year, Delegate Morgan put forward a bill to cut business sales tax. Right now, in the state of Maryland as a whole, if you buy a piece of equipment and they depreciate it over 10 years. So when you buy the equipment up front, you pay 6% Maryland state tax. And I can't remember the exact hundreds of the cost, but for the next 10 years, I think it's 2.25 or 2.27% of the remaining non-depreciated value you pay taxes on for the life of the item. So as an example, I have a small business, and my MacBook Pro is being depreciated over 10 years, which is ridiculous because it's not going to last that long, but that's kind of how they do it. So we thought it was a bad tax. He thought it was a bad tax. All the commissioners signed a letter, said, you know, it's fine if the rest of the state wants to do it, but we want it to be zero for St. Mary's County. We'd like to exempt St. Mary's County from that tax. So he took it up to the Assembly. It went to the House and Ways Committee. I went up to testify for it. They wouldn't even let it come out of committee. They just killed it because they didn't like it. And I repeatedly told them, and it was clear on the paper, it only impacted St. Mary's County, but they didn't like it. So it never saw the light of day.
So now the question to that would be, but can't the county commissioners set the rate?
So we can set the rate.
So they wanted, so you're wanting to eliminate the mechanism.
That's correct.
And they said, but you have the ability to set the rate. So if you want to set it to zero, you could.
That's correct.
And don't have to leave it at the 2.6 or 7. So you could set the.
See the
you
problem.
You could set it in place, though.
What you're saying is exactly correct. But if you're a company or a business looking to relocate to St. Mary's County, it would be a real good tax incentive if you knew that it wasn't up to the knuckleheads, the five commissioners who were could make that go back and forth at their whim by setting the code. If you just exempted St. Mary's County as a whole, it means a lot more to a new business thing than relocating it. That's why we went for state exemption versus just resetting zero.
And also the precedent too.
Yeah.
It would show that the state that you're serious about.
Yes, and the business personal property tax is also attached to the property tax itself, so you have to reduce both by a percentage. You can't just reduce one. And this would have been able to get rid of one as a whole, and while the other one wasn't affected, so you can only reduce by a certain percentage because they're actually tied together. So we went through that last time with Ms. Kramer, trying to figure out a way to actually do it. So this was a really good example of that.
Sounds great.
What did those rules taxes go to? Just to the state, the county? Or they go to the state?
Yeah, they go to the state initially, and then they come back.
I had an example.
Just 1 second. Hold on. We're not able to pick up some of your conversation, so we'll go ahead and pass this around as people speak.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. I'm Shelby Guazzo, and I had an example of this lady's question. Back in the 90s, the commissioners of the day it was time to enlarge the courthouse or expand it or move it. And at that time, the commissioners went to this Annapolis and requested bonding authority to rebuild the courthouse complex outside Leonardtown. And there was a fairly good groundswell of like, what are they thinking? And in local courtesy, killed that bonding authority request from the commissioners. And cooler heads took over and it remained in Leonardtown. So that was an example of, that was bonding authority that they needed to build the courthouse outside Leonardtown. And that was denied by local courtesy.
Anyone else, any more questions, or?
So the question would be,
go ahead, use this here.
Okay.
Under commissioner government right now, we would take up local legislation that's enacted by the state, and we're the ones, if we go under code home rule, we're then tied with Charles County because they're also a code county. So it would affect both of our counties at that point if it's something that has to be done by the state. So we're then sort of joined at the hip with them, and then instead of just having to get St. Mary's County commissioners and delegates and senators, now we need to also convince Charles County as well, because it affects both.
I think there could be a variety of different circumstances there. Yes, if the General Assembly was going to pass legislation that just affected the Southern Maryland class, then that is correct. They would obviously have to take into account, hopefully, the needs of both St. Mary's and Charles County. There can be a lot of situations where they're going to be looking much larger than a class, and this is a lot of what MACO deals with, is obviously statewide, so they're looking at the needs and issues of all counties. And I think that's probably the much larger class of issues, but you are correct with that. And that does introduce a different dynamic. There are some things that, instead of that, then they would just kind of look to say, deal with it locally, or the General Assembly would then do the class bill, or they would say, we'll just make it a broader mandate. So there are ways to, they can and do work around some of that.
Sir, you had a question?
Yeah.
So in regards to moving towards the code, would that be giving more discretion to the General Assembly, just on topics in general, speaking about any of the things listed on the previous slide? Or basically I'm saying, if we stayed in commission, would that give them more discretion on issues? And if we move to code, does that mean more things have to go through the General Assembly to allow them to make a change?
You're almost right. Right now, the commission form of government typically has to go to the General Assembly for the most amount of issues. If you move to code home rule, there'd be some issues that would be dealt with locally by your commissioners, and it would not have to go to the General Assembly. So you have a little more local autonomy under code home rule. However, as I went through some of the examples, there are still a number of things where the General Assembly will have control, and you've got to go through them.
Thank you.
Hey, anyone else got there? Any other questions from you? You had a good series going.
Okay, I'm just trying to understand the process. So on the flip side, what would happen under code home rule? It seems to me, I did see the PowerPoint from a different presentation, that the commissioners on a legislation date can propose legislation. There then is a period of, then there must be one hearing down here in the county. Presumably there could be more, but it's only required that there be one, at which one could have any kind of a quorum. It could be 10 people, it could be 100 people. And then within 40 days, that proposed law can go into effect without a referendum unless 10% of the county sign a petition requesting or demanding a referendum. Am I correct about that? And that sounds like lightning speed to me, so I just want to make sure I understand it.
Well, you are correct, but I'd have to check on the 40 days. I believe that is correct. The difference with the General Assembly, I mean, they're really actually, if you think about it, they're not much difference. They are only, they don't even have to have a bill hearing. Typically, they're required to. They have one hearing, so if it's a House bill, let's say it's called House Bill 5, it goes before the Environment and Transportation Committee in the General Assembly. They will have one hearing on it. Whoever shows up from the public is there. You get to testify. That's your only shot to really publicly testify on that bill, just the same. Then they have to just, if they want to pass a bill, it's got to be done before the end of the 90-day session, but sometimes they will pass it much more quickly. There are committees that will sometimes just call for a vote right there at the end of the bill hearing and say, vote favorable. They look around the table and they vote it out. So sometimes that's even faster. Now it does have to go across to the Senate, which is different. There, if they've already heard basically that same bill, they won't even have a hearing on it. It would just be for the sponsor. The bill sponsor will come in, public will not be allowed to testify, and then they can take the same action. So it really varies a lot, but I would kind of caution the General Assembly, even though it's 90 days, has kind of the same level of quick public participation, as well as being able to move a bill very fast. I mean, there has been bills introduced in the very last day of the General Assembly and gone through the entire process in one day. That is very rare, but if they want to get it done, they can get it done.
Okay, and that's a little different from what you were saying before about how one county's laws are sort of the last thing on the agenda, and they kind of tend to be shunted aside. But
well, I think, let me clarify that. One of the issues was, historically, when all counties were commissioner counties, obviously every single local, they had a huge number of local laws going to the General Assembly, so it created a glut, and it did cause problems where they just couldn't get to everything in the 90 days. That's why they created the charter form of government initially, to say, we need to get some of these local bills off our plate. Now that there's far fewer, I mean, there's only six commission counties remaining, they're not faced with quite that glut of local legislation. Charter counties and co-home counties have to put in legislation too, but it's a lot less. So that's not the issue. And where local laws sometimes come in is, as with any bills, they can get caught up in this process, and where this session, I think we're on track to potentially have a record number of bills, there will undoubtedly be some local laws as well as some statewide laws that just run out of time and will not get a fair hearing just because they've got so much to consider. But it isn't like they target local laws and say, oh, we're going to do these at the end. It's just that you get caught up in the general mix.
Anyone else? Huh? To me, the issue doesn't seem to be whether it's a 45-day or 90-day period or one hearing or two committee hearings or whatever. When you're talking about code home rule, you're talking about five people. They're all local. The county commissioners, I know where they all live. I can go talk to them. They're much more receptive when you're talking about going to the legislature. You're talking about 180 or 90 knuckleheads. And I don't even know the names of all of them. So
that'll be here tonight.
Yeah, well, so the issue to me is it's more local. The people are more responsive, more receptive, even though they may have limited authority. The more authority that you can bring locally, as opposed to having to go to Annapolis and ask somebody from Baltimore or PG County what their opinion is of St. Mary's excise taxes. The more we can do locally, the better. Thank you.
That was a good comment. I would take anyone else.
Well, to counter that, I would also note that the first step would be taking it to the local state delegates, and those are local for each district here.
Sir,
so
we can't hear you at all if you're not. We'll be on the tape.
Start over again.
Well, the first step would be taking it to the to our local state delegates, and they also are local, so you know, that's where we have to get it past them to get them to agree also to take it to the state. So whether it's code home rule or there's commissioner, we'll still, if it's certain things that need to go to the state, we'll still need their backing. And those are local people as well.
So just add to that currently 40% of our local representatives don't live in St. Mary's.
Staff, thank you very much for your presentation. Very well done. Okay, for those of you who have signed up to speak, I think Bobby Lott has already spoken and already answered questions. But if you would please, it's now time for all your comments. Sign in sheets provide the table as you've signed in. I have it right here now. We ask that you keep your remarks to 3 minutes. We will now open to the hearing for public comments. Mr. Fairfax?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah, please go to the podium. So we need to record this, so we need you to have you speaking into the microphone there, please.
Thank you, President Guy and Commissioner members. Provide a copy to Ms. Sharon there. Four quick things. I'm in favor of code rule for St. Mary's County, number one. Number two, I believe the code rule will make the Board of County Commissioners a more effective and efficient organization. Three, code rule allows the Southern Maryland delegation to focus on larger state issues, and there are plenty. Four, I would ask that the commissioners, because I've been through this process before, and I firmly believe that if this is what we want, that the county commissioners support the code home rule, again, that it go before referendum, let the people decide. But I think it's important that the commissioners raise their hand and say, we're either for or against this. Hopefully you're for it if you want the thing to progress ahead. I'm done.
Thank you, perfect. Randy. Bruce
Thielen. Thank you, sir. As I spoke earlier, I just think that the more local control we have, the better. And that would free up Annapolis to do bigger and big picture things. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Mr. James Riley.
Thank you, Commissioner, for the opportunity to present comments on behalf of the St. Mary's County Farm Bureau. My name is Jamie Raley, and I'm president of our County Farm Bureau. Farm Bureau has worked frequently with county government over the years to address a number of issues concerning agriculture, such as ordinances, changes to existing laws to support new on-farm ventures, agricultural land preservation, and most recently, ag education. And we appreciate the courtesy of previous boards and their assistance and the continuing assistance of this board. We thank you very much for that. We found over the years that the county commissioner form of government has served the farming community well. The Farm Bureau Board of Directors discussed the proposal for changing to St. Mary's County government to a code home rule. And we were trying to get down to the, to use a farming term, down to the seed of it or the kernel of it to figure out why we were doing this. And it appears that the genesis for this change came out of frustration by some over how long it took to adopt a property management ordinance for the county. Proponents of the change for code home rule and some of the documentation that you look at over there suggest that if the county had a was a code home rule type of government, the process to enact ordinances like a property management ordinance could take as little as 90 days. So to put this matter in perspective, it's appropriate, I think, to very briefly review the timeline involved that took to create that property management ordinance, since that seems to be the nexus of this issue. When the county, St. Mary's County's Chamber of Commerce created a task force at the behest of the county commissioners, they convened it in the fall of 2010, and its focus was drafting the language for the ordinance to address the problem of blighted properties in the developmental district, which was generally down here in Lexington Park. It took the task force a year to draft the language for the bill and do the research. And then the Board of Commissioners that existed in 2012 didn't act on that for a number of reasons and for a whole year. Once they did act on it and sent it to the request of the legislation from Annapolis, that took a 10-month process, and then there was a 4-month process for local public hearings. And then the ordinance was enacted in January of 2014. So it was 38 months from the time that roughly that the task force started until the data was voted on and put into a local ordinance. So we considered what was the downside on this issue. The citizens task force was afforded opportunity to research the issues pertaining to property management and write the draft. Recommendations were reviewed by county and state officials. The local press was instrumental in reporting the progress of the proposed ordinance. The farmers had an opportunity to weigh in on this and get some exemptions for agricultural issues because there were no farmers on that original task force. And at the end of the day, local citizen property rights were protected by the lengthy but deliberative process of developing this ordinance. So we didn't find that there was really any downside on that particular issue. Very quickly, though, some other proponents for Code Home Rule have expressed dissatisfaction that county government had to obtain legislative authority to make changes to the county's animal control ordinance, specifically pertaining to dog licenses. And yeah, we saw that coming down the pipe, but the legislation to change the local animal law was passed in the 2015 session. And the portion of the local law pertaining to dog licenses on our county, it's been addressed. However, to date, though, Farm Bureau is not aware of any draft ordinance created under that new legislation to provide a comprehensive system for animal regulation in our county, suggesting that perhaps there was not really any urgent or compelling need to change that animal law. Just took a little while to go through the process. So in conclusion, Farm Bureau has not found a convincing need for the change to Code Home Rule. Rather, a deliberative process with significant citizen input through public hearings and citizen task forces, as it exists now under our current commissioner form of government, is preferred. So Farm Bureau does not support Code Home Rule.
Thank you, Joe.
You're quite welcome, sir. Thank you for your time.
Yes, sir.
Just Larry Blosky.
And thank you for holding this discussion tonight. I am in favor of home code rule. I think as far as representative democracy, there's really no excuse for not going to this forum. I head the health department over in Calvert County, and my staff and I understand our county's needs better than people in Baltimore or Anne Arundel County or Garrett County. Most of the authority that we have in matters that we deal with is with us. It's not with people up in Baltimore or other places. I just can't imagine trying to do for the citizens of the community that we're responsible for if I had to go for every decision of the people in Baltimore or Annapolis. Mentioned incorrectly 40%, and Commissioner Hewitt was good enough to correct me that it's 50% of our elected state officials don't live in St. Mary's County. I think I still have a specter of Roy Dyson in the back of my head. And even for the two who do live in St. Mary's County, that means that most of the committees that legislation will be in front of, they will not be represented on that committee. And even if they are, let's face it, they have R's behind their names, and the people who run the state legislation have D's behind their names. So if there's a piece of legislation we really need, it's not going to get moved to the head of the line. Howard County stuff's going to get moved to the headline, Baltimore County stuff's going to get moved. It's not going to be St. Mary's. So having the ability to do what we need to locally, it's best for the citizens of this county. It keeps, as was mentioned before, it keeps our local commissioners more responsible to their citizens, and probably would keep the citizens more involved in what's going on, knowing that they could just come up and talk to the commissioners. So thank you for the time.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, that's the list for those who signed up. Is there anyone else who would like to speak at this time? We'll give you, if you didn't sign up to do it, you may do so at this time. If anyone else would like to ask any questions or give any comments. It's good to give name and address so we write it down here. Oh, Keith, I'm sorry, you already signed up. You signed up. No, you didn't sign nothing.
I was waiting to see how it went.
Oh.
I wanted to hear the presentations.
You can put yes on her now then?
You can put yes on there
okay.
now. My name is Keith Harless, 23225 Moorfield Lane, Lexington Park, Maryland. First, I'd like to thank Mr. Knapp for his presentation. Found it very informative, and for your questions and answer session. To be honest, I certainly have spoken before this group before, and my leanings have been towards against code home rule. I'm not for it or against it. I'm still in the discovery phase. I certainly have found that recently the county commissioners have certainly been able to do things with laws to enact things to without having to go to the state to do things. Have things done, such as the dog licenses, the business property taxes are still within their realm. Sign issues, other things have you found ways to work within the system to bring upon the local. The other concerns are, and the other thing was, after seeing the current county commissioners on November 17th and the way that the local laws session went, I would say the code home rule having more formality, that would be a plus. That certainly would be something that would be beneficial. And even without that, just more formality to the process so that it would perhaps go a little better, be more informative as to what you want, things like that. On the downside of code home rule, I'm a little concerned with the being tied with the other county, in Charles County, with the things that have to go to the state. So now, even though my other legislators are in Calvert County, it's still close by. They still have public hearings down here. So now having to learn Charles County and expand that scope does concern. So, but I'd like to thank Mr. Knapp once again for all the information and for the county commissioners for holding these hearings. Each one has been building upon each other, upon each one, to present the information to the citizens. We appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Any others would like to speak your piece about it? More information is better. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Marcia Greenberg, Memory Lane in St. Mary's City. I'm not speaking for or against either approach. I think these are things that we all have to think about carefully, and that as voters we need to understand. I do appreciate the efforts made to hold hearings, and I had heard before that they were very much hearings just to hear from our side, and I very much appreciate that there's now information coming. No citizen should be making a decision on any issue without being well informed. So my concern, and what I'm hopeful we can all learn more about, is that there are advantages to being able to expedite things and get things done quickly, and there are also very important advantages to a deliberative process of government, that it does take a while for people to get to understand what a bill is all about, who the winners and the losers are, and unfortunately, almost everything involves some losers, not just winners. And so my only concern, and I just hope this gets kind of teased out and understood in the process, is that it's my understanding that through the code home rule process, any particular commissioner can propose legislation. That then goes to one hearing, and with a vote of 3 out of 5 of you, and it's a small group. I mean, and this is not against any particular individual, but 5 people, for one individual to be able to find 2 others who are willing to vote with him, maybe sometime her, doesn't take a whole lot necessarily. And there may be issues of some gravitas, of some importance, that could happen, could be decided quite quickly. I understand that the citizens can then put together 10% of the population signatures in order for there to be a referendum to consider something, but it's always then feels like you're pushing a ball back up the hill. That's a tall order. So I just think we all need to be careful. On the one hand, when we want to see things done, we get frustrated, things don't happen fast enough, and we really want to see expedited procedures. And there are other cases, however, in which I think a deliberative process, particularly when people are busy and are not necessarily moderating things carefully that are happening. It is right here at the local level. We do get to know you all more. Commissioner Jargo, I've seen you so many times in the last week or so that you're probably sick of my face. I'm not sick of yours, though. But that's the tension. And I'm hopeful that you all as commissioners understand that, as should the citizens of St. Mary's County, because clearly people have made decisions in both directions. And I understand that this question has been put forward before, probably before I was a resident here, and it's been voted down before. So thank you very much for putting the information forward, and I would encourage everybody in the county to begin to really tease this out and look at, there's not an easy answer, obviously. And the advantages and the disadvantages to both means that whichever option is selected means that it will be selected along with its disadvantages, and may the best decision win. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yep. Mr. President, just wanted to correct one thing. Code home rule has never been proposed before in St. Mary's County. In 1972, and I believe the second time, I always get fuzzy, but it's either 89 or 94, charter government was proposed and rejected by the voters.
Okay,
but
thank you.
Just wanted to clarify that.
Mm-hmm.
And how many legislative items do we have going up to?
I believe the commissioners have forwarded 18 legislative requests to the delegation. And again, the delegation made it quite clear that they weren't all going to be probably introduced or pushed forward. As a matter of fact, the statement was made that every 1 year you may have 5 good ideas and only 2 of them are going to go through. So I guess the question becomes, what about the other 3 good ideas? So.
And most of them were reported, about 12 of them are actually changes to laws that we have presently on the books that have been superseded by state or other?
Yes, most of them are repeals of local laws, not enactment of new laws that are either unnecessary or duplicate laws that have now been assumed by the state. Because, quite frankly, I think Mr. Knapp might agree, most legislative power still resides with the state.
The slow and deliberative process, at a minimum, it's one hearing. And as you can see, at least from this board, at a minimum, you have to have 2 hearings for a code home rule. This board decided that we wanted to have 7 before we brought it to referendum. So we decided that 2 wasn't enough, and before we even made a vote to get the public input. So when it comes to legislation, you know, at a minimum, it's one hearing that you would have to have. So there's nothing stopping the board on legislation to say that we would have 2 or 3 hearings, or forming a committee prior to submitting legislation that would say, if we're looking at something that's gonna, let's say it is a, we'll use the same topic of the blight ordinance, that we wanna have a committee that gets together, a citizens committee, that comes together with the best of the ideas and helps with the legislation, then it comes forward and it comes there, and we have multiple hearings on it. So there's nothing stopping us from doing that, or it's actually extending the time frame in which that bill goes in to accommodate that. So that's just the minimum requirement that is actually set in place. So I think a good example of the deliberative process would be that this board came together and realized that this is a large process, there's a lot of information that needs to be given, and it is a big decision, and that we had extra hearings for that. And I would say that with this point, you don't have a crystal ball as to what anybody else in the future would do, but it has been the precedent set through the history of the Board of Commissioners that the next board does respect the precedent of the previous board with public hearings. And that has been the case where there is really nothing set in stone as to how many hearings we must actually have. But usually we do have 1 to 2 public hearings, if not 3, on certain topics based on previous precedent. So I don't think that would change just because the type of government would change. And I would hope that the history there would be respected in that aspect, and a deliberative process that respects the people would say. And that's where I see it, and I hope we're setting a good precedent by having these hearings and as setting a good example for the people that we want to keep that in mind when we're listening to you.
Okay. If no one else wishes to speak, before you leave tonight, we encourage you to stop by the display table right over here to my right, your left over there, and take home some materials that we have provided. Including the materials is the web address for the Code Home Rule page on the county's website. The web page includes a log of the questions received by citizens to date and the county's responses. Thank you all for being here tonight. Your participation in this process is greatly appreciated. If you have any additional comments or questions, please mail them to the Commissioners of St. Mary's County at P.O. Box 653, Leonardtown, Maryland 20650, or you may email us at CodeHomeRule@stmarysmaryland.com. That's CodeHomeRule@stmarysmd.com. Commissioners, y'all have anything else to add? Okay. Well, I now close tonight's public hearing.